much have you guys already done with the day end? You could say nothing. You could say something. You could say a whole book. To what exactly?
Talked about the different philosophers and kind of like what their style was. Like Plato used myths and dialogue. Aristotle used realism.
He didn't go into the text itself.
No.
Okay. Well, we will definitely do that. He had asked me to do two classes on the what we call the induction of this soul that we talked about at that.
Well, he said that was in book two.
So I guess I'll just give a little bit of an introduction. It's brief, much briefer than this, I'm sure. Because, I mean, Aristotle's such an old guy. I mean, really, we're really digging up some, unearthing some ancient bones of philosophy here. It's good stuff, though. Now, what I sent you as a text is, I love it because it gives you the Greek, and it also has St. Thomas's commentary after that with the Greek and or with the English and the Latin as well. Because famously, translations are treason, betrayal. You've betrayed. And, you know, that's always the challenge in making a translation. You try to help the reader understand. Have you really understood? Sometimes the helpfulness of a translator is actually not very helpful. Couldn't you just translate it literally? Well, what did they really mean by the words? Because at different times, the words had slightly different meanings, blah, blah, blah. Now, I don't speak Greek. Neither do you. So I could pretend like I did, and you would probably not believe me. But there are a fair amount of Greek words, and turn off the screen auto shut off. I'm not going to mess with it. Anyway, long and short of it is there are some key words that are good to be familiar with, so that as you're reading the translation and saying, what on earth is he talking about? Then you can look at the original words and be like, I still don't understand that. But I know which word it was. And sometimes there's little clues because in places, even in this translation, the translator is trying to, I guess, help understand, help the reader understand something. But in fact, using completely different words or words with big obtuse endings on them. So, well, I mean, it may have some kind of bearing, but anyway, I wouldn't pretend like I'm a better translator, but the goal of the translators are. Now, also, I'm not sure, this was put together by this translation was put together by a Dominican, and all of his stuff is available online. So I just created a PDF file out of the website that has this laid out. This guy named Kinney, Joseph died a few years ago, and all of the work that he did almost went into oblivion. All of us little Catholic nerds used to going to a site and then it was like disappeared, like writing the Dominicans, please put his site back up. So it died, so it was time to take care of it. Anyway, so we resurrected a lot of the texts, not all of them. So this is a great resource. I don't know if he did the translation himself into English. Kind of doubt it. I think that what the English that's here is the translation of the Latin. Which is what St. Thomas was using. St. Thomas was using a Latin translation that came from the Arabs themselves. So that's the sort of miserable predicament we end up with in a lot of these texts, is that there's the translation of the translation, words get lost, translators like, oh, let's simplify things. Why did you simplify things? Now we don't understand anything. Anyway, so I'll navigate a little bit of those things. We won't go too much into that because it would just give everyone time. But I'll make some jokes along the way, so easier to stomach. So book two, the first two chapters, I don't know if we're going to be able to get through both of them. I'd like to today. The first two chapters are definitely on the induction of the soul. The first chapter, if you expect that one to be the easier of the two, you're wrong. It's not. The first chapter is actually the more difficult of the two to understand, because there are not as many wonderful examples. Book two, chapter two, there's a lot more examples that make it easier to understand what's going on. Did Father Nathan talk about why induction of the soul is important at all? The answer is yes or no. No. Okay. Well, I'll do that just a little bit so that we know why on earth we keep talking about this. Now, who knows the difference between an induction and a deduction? Go ahead, raise your hand. Take some sign. Shake it.
A deduction would be with, like, eliminate things to come to
a conclusion. Right. A deduction is you start with different premises and you conclude. Okay. So you would start out with famous example, syllogism, deduction. All men are stinky. All men are mortal. Socrates is a man. Deduce it. Therefore, Socrates is a man. Ah, deduction. Now, so you're starting with all the premises and you are concluding something singular. Socrates, about Socrates. So you have A equals B. All men are mortal. Socrates, C is a man. A. Therefore,
C equals B.
Now, that doesn't work, and then there's this whole sophistical arguments. There's an interesting book on Aristotle where he analyzes sophistical arguments and why they don't work, things like that. So there's these false syllogisms that don't work. It's a different problem. Anyway.
I think Father Nathan was talking about this. I'm just slow to, like, recall information. He called it finding the cause from the effect.
Right. So, the classic is, so here we don't have any causes or any effects. A deduction is taken simply from the universal intelligibility of the realities that we're talking about. What is universally true about men? Mortal. Okay. Socrates is an example of a man. Therefore, we can conclude anything that's universally true about men, also to Socrates. Because Socrates is one of them. Now, an induction works the opposite sort of way. You start out with the facts, and you discover something that's hidden. Because here, there's nothing hidden. It's more or less obvious, depending on what grade you're in. Start out early first grade, it's a little harder to get there, but... By third grade, though, you ought to have all those critical thinking skills warming up in your little brain. You should be better by then. So, now if we're going to do an induction, on the other hand, We're going to begin not with statements about the universal, but with statements of effects. And the famous example here is, I see smoke. An effect of something. Therefore, conclusion.
There's
a fire. There you go.
Well, what Bree said, would that be a deduction?
That was not even. We didn't even move. We did a circle. We just circled the fire. Just like Indians dancing around the fire. No, so icy smoke, that's the effect. And the effect, the greater the necessity of the effect, the more conclusive my induction about the cause. So, if I can discover being, this is the whole goal here, philosophy, as an effect, that will lead me to discover the cause of being. Being, as it is detached, or independent, being as such is not connected necessarily to the physical manifestation, the sensitive knowledge of something. Being as it is at a different level, discovering being as an effect then allows me to induce a cause. That's what metaphysics is all about. Now, I threw that out there a little bit because already in the De Anima, we'll start to see in this first chapter a little bit of Aristotle's metaphysics coming out. St. Thomas will also comment on that a little bit. Now, so I think that the commentaries are interesting, St. Thomas' commentaries. Remember, and we mentioned this a little bit in the class on justice, St. Thomas is commenting on Aristotle's De Anima as a theologian, trying to draw out the conclusions that are important for a theologian. So while his reflections are analytical and help to understand Aristotle, his aim is not simply to communicate Aristotle's thought, but rather to show how Aristotle's conclusions and reasoning could be useful in a philosophy that is trying to receive God's revelation. So, in a mind trying to receive God's revelation. So, we'll not spend too much more time on that. But as you can see, the importance of an induction is to actually land on a cause. That is this power of my intellect that I'm the most interested in. If I have a soul, I would like to know it. What it is. And especially for us mortals, if my soul is simply something that will cease to exist at the end of my life, because I have known others who have passed, and I can wonder what happens when I die. And so there's a question of the immortality of the soul, which Aristotle deals with in a much more intelligent way than Plato, although Plato has some interesting things to say about as well. Harmony of the soul just doesn't go far enough to discover as immortal. That's what the induction is for. ultimately. Now, in the beginning, you can't start hoping that you'll just instantly come to this very clear, full knowledge of knowing your soul as something immortal, philosophically. Now, of course, we know our soul is immortal because of revelation, but the whole goal of philosophy is that, wait a minute, if the soul is something real and I can know it and say something true about it, then that means that I have some sort of contact with it, at least intellectually. And it's a real thing. So what is the full knowledge I can have? Well, I have to come back to this induction, come back to my experience, my own experience of my own life, discover, rediscover my soul in a progressively clearer way, discovering the different levels of life, we'll see that, what it means to be intelligent, what that is to be intelligent. That will give me, hopefully, with time, a certain knowledge of my soul as immortal. And that, if anything, should make this study interesting. Aristotle says with confidence, the human soul is immortal. And the philosophers, theologians that followed him said, Aristotle knew what he was doing. Well, certainly worth trying to follow in his footsteps to see if we too, with him, and those that saw him as a master, discover this, the immortality of our soul. The first step, first things first, just this discovery of the soul. So this first chapter has, as St. Thomas will say in his commentary on it, more general induction of the soul. And then in the second chapter, there's two approaches. There's an approach that just tries to get to the essential we call it causality of the soul. And then in chapter 2 of book 2, what we'll see is a discovery of the soul through a series of different analogies and vital operations. This first induction is much more intellectual, so it could be a little bit more painful. Those of us whose intellects are still wake up. But so don't worry if this one's difficult. The good news is the second part makes the first part easier. Why did he do this to us? Well, I don't know. He chose the order he did.
Could you state the end? You just said what this chapter 2 or the second part is.
So the second part
that we're going to get to.
Yeah. It's not the second part. It's the second chapter of book 2, which is immediately following this. Is a discovery of the soul by analogy. And by multiple vital operations. So what that means is you go from a discovery that's direct, simple, to a discovery that comes at the same reality from various different perspectives. So the pedagogy there, at least at this point. So I don't know why you would start with that. Maybe just to intimidate you, I'm not sure. Anyway, don't be intimidated. It's not too bad. So, here he says, hitherto we've spoken of what our predecessors handed down to us about the soul. But let us now reopen the inquiry from the beginning and endeavor to determine what the soul is and what is its most And here it says comprehensive definition. So here in the Greek, you've got the great question, TST, okay? What is the soul? Kai tis an eikoi notatos logos autos. So logos, as you also know probably, is this sort of vast word that doesn't just mean definition. What Aristotle is looking for here is not just a Webster's entry for the soul, because that's not interesting, unless you really don't know what the word means. But what he's looking for is the intelligibility. So in this particular place, I would translate logos as intelligibility. And an easy way to put that is simply the whatness. This isn't just a definition. It's coming into contact with what nourishes my intellect from reality. In reality, there's something that when I come into brute contact with it, suddenly my mind glows with the form, the intelligibility. Logos also can be translated. And unfortunately, for whatever reason, we like to translate that definition. It just falls very flat. Because if all I wanted was definitions, I wouldn't need to work so hard. I'll just give you the definition, then you can leave me alone. It's so much easier.
Is it, could you also say like essence? Like, or is that not?
Now, you'll see when I do Aristotle that I did use this word sort of just because it's kind of colloquial. It's a common word that you hear. Unfortunately, that word comes from Latin, and there's a bit of difficulty in really what that word means. And it's passed through theology. So we're going to leave essence, things like that, on the back burner. And as we're looking at logos, we're looking at reason, right? Discourse, form, the whatness, the intelligibility, all of these words are talking about something that's full of meaning and that you can't just simply put into a word or a series of words. That gets at what we're talking about, but what actually is more dense than the words we use to describe it. And that's the problem with the soul. What is the soul? I want, in my intellect, to come into contact with this reality that is the soul, so that I could put all different kinds of words on it if I wanted to, that were all accurate and true. I could come at it from different directions. But in order to do that, that's what we're trying to do. Let us now endeavor to begin again. So all the different ideas about soul, just pretend like we've never heard them, start over. That's what he's saying. That's what he's really doing. Now we say one of the kinds of things that are is substance. Of this, there's one element, matter, which of itself is no particular thing. Another, the form or species according to which it is called this particular thing. The third, that which is from both of these. Matter is indeed potency, and the form act. And this latter has two modes of being. One, like knowledge possessed, the other, like the act of knowing. So, if you got anything out of that, congratulations. If you didn't, don't feel bad, because it's pretty thick. Let's break it down a little bit. Now, this little statement here, a lot of it comes from a more thorough examination of matter. That we see in the physics. So, in some ways, the physics, Aristotle's physics, is predecessor to the Deianic. Makes sense, and we'll see that in a bit. These physical realities, physical body, there are physical bodies that are alive, and there are physical bodies that are inanimate. without soul, without this cause of life. So we're trying to get to this special form that's not just a physical form, but a vital form. So let's look at some of these key words here. We say that one of the kinds of things that are is substance. That one we didn't write down. So ti ton onton, so something of being, it is ousian, so that's substance. When you hear the word substance, it's coming from this Greek word ousian. Now, where did the word ousia come from? Anybody know? There's a creative etymology from Plato. It says that ousia comes from, it's a deformation of the word Estia. Estia was the Greek goddess who always stayed at home. She never came out. She always stayed at home. So Plato says that the ousia, that which always remains. Alright, that's super funny. Come on. Estia, the goddess Estia. It was a brother. He thought that was so funny. He wanted to change his religious name to Estia. I always stay home.
Is that you?
No, it wasn't. Yeah. It was more like he wanted to go out and he never got to. So he was... He said, they should just call me Brother Estia. Oops, oh no. I didn't want to do that. Okay, good. Oh no. Oh goodness. Okay. Here we are. Okay, so we've got the ousia. That's the substance. The oule is matter. And that's actually, interestingly enough, word for wood. So as he's speaking about matter, he doesn't have this sort of abstract notion in his brain, but ule, which is hule, which is the word for wood. So that's one that corresponds to matter. And then we have this, another, the form or species according to which it is called this particular thing. There we have two words for form that are not in the translation. Shame on you, translator. The morphe and, morph, so you see right here, morphein kai eidos. Morphe and the eidos. So the form, that's what we traditionally understand as eidos.
Didn't he say the form or species?
Yeah, but species according to which it is called this particular thing, that's where he says legetai tode ti, according to which it is called this thing, tode ti, this particular thing. So the eidos and then the morphos. Why is that important? Because you have in art a certain kind of form and in nature a different kind of form. This is the form of a tree that's been cut down. There's a form of a rock. And then there's an eidos, which is another kind of form that's introduced if you make a sculpture. So it's coming from somewhere else. It's a different form. It's not a natural form. This is the eidos, and then there's this morphos that's already found in a physical reality. So even before there's been an intervention by man, there's already a form that's identifiable in a physical reality. Right? You're going to have to leave if you can't control yourself.
So the morphos is
the
physical.
Well, now the problem is a form is that which we distinguish from matter.
Yeah, right.
So
like
There's a kind of form that's natural, naturally occurring in the world around us, and that's this morphos. The eidos is another kind of form that's more spiritual. Because you can either have an idea, I had a thought. You can have also an artistic form that's worked into the matter, and that's this eidos. And it has to, at some level, coordinate with the morphos. So we'll take a wonderful example of that. You can't, you know, if you want to make something with wood, you want to find a good piece. There's not a knot in it somewhere that, or sometimes you're working with it and then you find a knot in your, or clay, you want it to not crack when you're working with it. There's something natural about the form of physical reality that you may be working with. And if you're trying to impress, work into that matter, a new form, you have to be able to cooperate with the one that's already there. Because the matter is ready to be transformed. It's malleable to a certain extent, depending on what its natural form is. Morphos. Morphos and eidos. It's two different forms. A third, which is from both of these. And it just says a third, which is from both of these. Kai triton to ekto. And that is this combination. It's interesting because when Aristotle goes to do an induction of the ousia as a principle of being in the metaphysics, he uses a similar sort of demonstration when he talks about the formation of a syllable. And you can break a syllable down to its elements, B, B is one thing, A is another thing, and Ba is something else. But it's a combination of those two elements. So in a similar way, as he's looking at matter and form, and then their combination, you've got something else that appears. And so that's what we're looking for with this soul. There's matter, there's a form, and there's something else that appears. Because a living body isn't just arms, legs, hands, feet made out of flesh. There's something else. It's a lie. What does that mean? Matter indeed is indeed potency. So the hule is dunamis, and that's that famous word for potency, which you'll see over and over again. Dunamis, there's even some ministries named dunamis. It's a very popular word in the New Testament as well. Potency, power. So the matter, it says, is in potency, and the form is act. So eidos intelekeia. So already we have introduced this gigantic word intelekeia. In Elikea one of the defects of these translations that you'll see. There's actually another word for act, and that's energeia. Which is also the word for work in Greek. Entelecheia is a word that Aristotle invented. You won't find this word anywhere else before Aristotle. And it's a composed word. It's one of those, we call this conjunction. Compound word. So it's in telos echeia. And those words mean the end. We've looked at that already once before. The end, the telos. And echeia is the word to have. And so end. A having in the end, in telekeia. So there's these two significance, there's two meanings of act. Now act is this last principle that we discover in metaphysics, but it's already present, these other levels of philosophy, the philosophy of the living being, also in ethics. And probably in ethics, that's where the difference between in telekeia and in energeia is the most manifest. Because what is the end of your human life? Happiness or the good? What's the difference between happiness and the good? Isn't happiness good? Happiness is good, but if I'm looking for happiness, how am I going to find it? So there's this strange sort of interplay between the good and happiness. Happiness is entelecheia, a having in the end. There is, for the subject, a kind of fullness that can only happen when they are in the end, in their end. And energeia is the radical cause of that act, that having in the end. So, and St. Thomas, since even though his translations were deficient, he perceived that there was something strange going on. You'll see him sometimes refer to Act 1 and Act 2, or first act and second act. Not like a play, but just like in substance, there's first substance and second substance. We'll see that more in a while. There's also first act and second act for St. Thomas Aquinas. And trying to understand that there's this interplay. There's the effect in the subject of being in my end, happiness. And then there's the actual cause of my happiness, which is something else other than me, that I can't have just by trying to understand happiness. Self-help books. Look at yourself. Make yourself happy, but we need something outside of us. So that's this difference between the energeia and the entelecheia. So as he here is talking about the act, he's saying, now the form, matter is indeed potency, and the form, act. But what kind of act? Entelecheia. And this latter has two modes of being, one like knowledge possessed, the other like the act of knowing. So that's this same difference here, entelecheia and energeia. Knowing, having knowledge, that's this here, episteme, right? Having knowledge, as knowledge, or as teorein, which is often translated as a kind of contemplation. So it's a contemplative knowledge. You see that in the Gospel of St. John. That which we have seen, So this, teorein, is the act of knowing. That's the comparison. just as there's a difference between happiness and the good, so there's a difference between having knowledge and the act of knowing. And what he's trying to see is this form that remains in that reality. Matter of importance in the form act, giving it stability, instead of substance. Bodies especially seem to be substances. And among these, natural bodies. For these are the principles of the others. Of natural bodies, some possess vitality, others do not. We mean by possessing vitality that a thing can nourish itself and grow and decay. So, having life, aka Zawe, or not having. We mean by possessing vitality that a thing can nourish itself and grow and decay. Now, that's an interesting thought. What's the definition for Aristotle of being alive? Or where do you see in there Aristotle's understanding of life?
Something that's developing from within? Is that what you mean? Like where it says it can nourish itself and grow.
Nourish itself and grow and decay. You read St. Thomas's commentary on it. St. Thomas moves towards a different definition, being something that can move itself. It'd be interesting to see why he does that. Aristotle says that,
say from a pro life standpoint, it would be two definite things that would be definitely two different things to argue separately. Mm-hmm. Being able to nourish yourself versus being able to move yourself. Being in a womb, two different things, somebody can go two different directions with that.
That's true. Very true. And I think that if we paid attention to St. Thomas's understanding of moving oneself, what he understands by that is not locomotion, but an activity, a kind of movement that is not simply a physical displacement, but something spiritual. We'll talk about it. We'll see that in this commentary. Now, so it's interesting that for Aristotle, on the other hand, he sees this basic form of life, this very fundamental kind of way of living, as expressed in what we'll call assimilation.
Father, this could apply to vegetative life too, right? Like, is that what we're talking about? Like, you're just saying what life is.
Yeah, so he's just saying, of natural bodies, some possess, and there it says vitality, just life. Others do not. We mean by possessing vitality, having life, that's all that means, possessing vitality is a really complicated way of just saying having life, or not having life. Life, we say, as eating, tophane, that's the word that just means to eat, and obsessing, and augmenting, growing, increasing, and then decay. That's the word that means towards death. So, growth and decay. Eating, and then growth. Therefore, every natural body sharing in life will be a substance. And this substance will be, in some way, composite. That was the word I was looking for. Since, however, it is a body of such and such a nature, i.e., having life, the soul will not itself be the body. For the body is not one of the factors existing in the subject. The upokainama, that's the underlying, what's underneath it all. So the subject, sub, right? Subject. Think of what's underneath it all, what's at the bottom, where everything else sits on top of it. That's what the subject is. body is not one of the factors existing in the subject. Rather, it is as the subject in the matter. So we'll see that as Aristotle's analysis, that what is material is what is radically potential, has radical potential, and requires a form to be something. Matter doesn't exist simply in a pure state. It always exists with some kind of a form, as something. So that's why this, for material realities, for physical bodies, what is at the baseline of them is something, a material potential. So that's this radical subject. Everything else can be attributed to this reality because it is somewhere. It is made of something. It appears. So the radical subject, that which is at the bottom of this physical reality, at the foundation of it, is this material cause, this material causality, which is a potential to be, to exist, but by itself doesn't exist. Therefore, every natural body sharing in life will be a substance, and this substance will be in some way composite. Since, however, it is a body of such and such nature, in other words, being alive, the soul will not itself be the body. For the body is not one of the factors existing in the subject. Rather, it is the subject. It is as the subject in the matter. It is necessary then that the soul be a substance in the sense of the specifying principle of the physical body potentially alive. So, that's a really complicated way of saying these words in Greek. The substance, ousion, enai, has as form, eidos, form, the body, the physical body, physiku, with the potency, dunamai, of life, having the potential for life. So the soul is a substance, in this sense, of being the principle of a physical body with the capacity for life. So Thomas comments on that. It's very interesting. He doesn't say a physical body that is alive, because the soul is that principle of life. That principle, we'll see later, of vital operations. So he says that it's the soul is the substance in this sense that it is that principle that causes a physical body that is potentially alive to exist. Substance, in this sense, is act. And there, in the sense of entelecheia. So the substance, the soul, is something that is had by the reality. It's a possession. It's an end that's possessed, like happiness. It will therefore be the act of a body of this sort. Now this can mean one of two things. One, as the possession of knowledge. Another, as the act of knowing. So we're going to come back on this understanding of act. And that's between the episteme and the theore. Which is just an example. You don't have to understand how knowledge works to understand this example. Another is the act. It's plain that it is like knowledge possessed. The soul is like knowledge possessed. That's what he's saying. The soul remains in the body whether one is asleep or awake. Knowledge also remains in you whether you are awake or asleep. Don't wake up and forget everything. Some of you may feel that way, but of course, there's amnesia, but that's a defect. That's not how knowledge works. The way knowledge works is it leaves an imprint in you and its impotency, and you can call it back to act. Being awake is comparable to the act of knowing, sleep to possession without use. Knowledge is possessed, knowledge possessed is prior in the order of generation and one the same thing. That line's a little bit fishy. St. Thomas tries his best to explain it. The soul, therefore, is the primary act of a physical body capable of life. Great little thing to write down if you want to. The soul, therefore, is the primary act of a physical body capable of life. It's the same sort of definition that we had a little bit earlier, but put a little bit different. Does the soul be a substance in the sense of the specifying principle of a physical body potentially alive? The soul, therefore, primary act of a physical body capable of life. Primary act in what sense? This entelecheia, that which remains. Such a body will be organic. Parts, plants, and deeds are organs, though very elementary. The leaf is the covering of the whatever, blah, blah, blah. Roots, too, are analogous to mouths. It doesn't say like mouths. It says analogon, for both draw in nourishment. So what he's indicating is simply that each kind of living being, as they have this common level of life, vegetative life, have organs that are also analogous. As an example, roots are like mouths. Thought about it that way. Thinking of flower is more like the face, the shiny face, but really the head of the flower is in the ground. Because that's where it has to direct itself. Everything else is just absorbing the light, but to seek out the food, that's the roots that are doing that. So it's almost like plants. Yeah, from the previous paragraph, the one up here, specifying that one. Say again.
Like when it says the soul is a primary act of the physical body, is that the same thing as saying the soul is a substantial form of the physical body?
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. Mm-hmm. And then could you say that the soul, so it's principle of life, but the soul in itself is not alive? The body
is alive by the soul.
But the soul in itself.
Well, there's, I mean, the problem, here's the other problem. The word life is not, it's descriptive. Life doesn't talk about, it's like, it begs the principle. Is the problem with the word life. Is that it's not something that directly describes experience. It's like an abstraction of phenomena that I associate with what I call living beings, life. So life itself is not a thing. It's the way I look at reality and understand that some physical bodies, you know, have this other thing that they do that manifests itself in a lot of different ways, different vital operations. And I group those all together in a confused mess and I say, that's life. So there's a bit of a problem philosophically with using the word life. If we try to make that the soul or the principle, it's better to talk about vital operations. Because I actually can't experience vital operations. Whereas life, I don't experience life directly. It's an indirect thing. I experience directly breathing, sleeping, seeing, listening, thinking. Those are things that I actually experience. Whereas life, is like at a second degree. Does it make sense? That's real important to grasp. Because for the discovery of the soul, we have to move away from this sort of cloudy understanding of life to what life is actually consists of. And those are specific vital operations connected to organs.
Father, is what you're saying that as we're going to be using the language to discover the soul, life or vital operation, it's really it's essentially like a physical / biological thing.
Right.
So it's not helpful to apply it to the soul because the soul's not a physical biological thing.
The problem with the word life is that it's a generic term that we could easily there's the word in French for it, chosifier, make it into a thing. But life as yet doesn't exist as a thing. It exists under the auspices of vital operations, which are very different from each other. But we can simplify with the word and the common knowledge, what is actually my experience, vital operation, by putting this funny label on it, life, and then I'm like, oh, well, life is just the soul. But I didn't actually discover anything, because I just turned a vague conglomeration of different experiences into this thing that is a concept. Reality of reason. Rather than a principle. Life is not the principle. Life does not cause vital operations. When I see vital operations or I experience vital operations, I'm like, these are all signs of life. But I'm saying less about my experience when I use the word life than if I were speaking directly about if then there is any one generalization to be made for any and every soul, the soul will be the primary act of a physical bodily organism. There you go, there's another little definition-y thing for you, if you like. Once again, this kind of definition that Aristotle is looking for is an intellectual one that's trying to just put things in terms of metaphysical principles. Entelecheia, that's the part talking about the principle. Proton, somatos, the body, physicu, organic, an organic physical body. So he's putting it in these kind of rich terms that all have, each one of them has a whole backlog of a philosophical meaning. So this first jab at the soul is an intellectual one. In the next section, hence it is unnecessary to inquire whether the soul and the body be one, any more than whether wax and an impression made in it are one. There's a nice little example-y thing for you to think about. The soul and the body are one, just like in an analogous way to the wax and the impression that's made in it are one. So the stamp, the seal, right? It's one. Why would you say that the wax is different from the form that it carries? The image that's stamped in the wax, the one. Well, the soul and the body are also one. Now, I think that one of the things you can do, if you enjoyed or didn't, or if you were confused by different sections, is you can see there's little paragraph numbers at the end, like here, for example, 217 through 19. Those are the paragraphs in St. Thomas's commentary where he looks specifically at those paragraphs. So it's split up, and you can just go and look at it. And St. Thomas is generally consoling in his explanations, although occasionally gets even more heady. So you can read that if you would like. And if you are all ready to move on to the next section, which would be great, you can start reading the definition explained, soul and body. And I think, so this is still chapter 1, I'm sorry. But this is definitely the second section that I was talking to you about, where you've got a bunch more examples, things that are talking more about analogies. I would recommend, before the next class, if you have time, to take a look at that part. If you were interested in the part that we looked at and wanted to investigate further, you've got St. Thomas's commentary. But if you were kind of discouraged, skip that and start reading the second part, which probably you'll be able to get a lot of it on your own. And then if you've got questions on it, you can bring those with you next time. I believe we'll continue on Wednesday with this. So tomorrow evening, we have a special